Hi everyone, welcome to ClubSyn. This video tutorial is all about concepts of object orientation. At the end of this video tutorial, you will be able to understand the various approaches to solve a software problem. There are two approaches, procedural approach and object oriented approach. After understanding these approaches, you will understand the concepts of objects, you will understand the concepts of class. And lastly, you will know the pillars of object orientation, which are abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism. In this session, we will understand the various approaches to solve a software problem. There are two approaches to solve a software problem. The first approach is procedural approach of solving a problem, and the second approach is object-oriented approach of solving a problem. In order to understand both these approaches, let us take a case study wherein my mom tells me to serve her a cup of tea. Now, this is a problem to me. In order to solve this problem, I will take approach one where I can take approach one where I will go to the kitchen, I will take a bowl, I will put some water in it, I will put sugar, tea leaves in it, I will lit the gas, I will boil the tea, I will filter the tea, pour it in a cup, and then I will serve it to my mom. What I did in this entire exercise, I answered the question, how will I serve my mom a cup of tea? And in order to answer this how, I land up in writing an algorithm. Going to the kitchen and doing the entire exercise is nothing but I wrote an algorithm. This approach of solving a problem where I wrote the entire algorithm is known as procedural approach of solving a problem. Now the same problem of serving my mom a cup of tea can be done in following another approach, wherein I will try to identify a relevant person who will write the same algorithm on my behalf. So let's say I'm having a gardener in my house, I'm having driver in my house, I'm having a maid in my house, and out of these three, I will identify the maid who is a relevant person here, because she only knows how to make a cup of tea. I will identify maid and she will write the entire algorithm which I wrote in the previous approach to solve this problem. So how did I solve the problem using the second approach? By identifying the relevant person who wrote the entire algorithm on my behalf, which was maid in this case. So in this second approach, I answered the question who will solve this problem, and when I identified the maid as an answer to this who, maid is nothing but a noun, and any noun exists in this real world because the definition of noun is it's a name of a person, place, animal or thing. So any noun exists in this real world, and anything which exists in this real world is nothing but an object. So in the second approach, what I did is I identified the relevant object. The maid was in this case, the maid was the real object who wrote the entire algorithm on my behalf. Who am I in both these approaches? I am the software developer. So if we try to differentiate between these two approaches, in the first approach, the software developers focuses on writing the algorithm. And in the second approach, which is an object-oriented approach, the software developer focuses on identifying the relevant objects to solve the problem. So these are the two approaches to solve a software problem. In this session, we will understand what is an object. An object is a real-life entity. Now when I say an object is an entity, which means it has an existence in the real life. Why an object exists? For example, if you say I am an object and I am existing, why you are saying so I am existing? You are saying that I am existing because I am having certain properties in me. For example, eyes, hands, legs, ears, these are my properties. And using these properties, I exhibit certain behaviors. For example, with the help of my legs, I exhibit a behavior called walking. With the help of my ears, I exhibit a behavior called hearing. So, an object is anything that exists in this real world, which has certain properties and behaviors in it. So, in order to define an object is anything that exists in real life having certain properties, and using those properties, an object exhibits certain behaviors. When I map these properties and behaviors in my object-oriented program, these properties will be mapped to the data of the program, and these behaviors will map to the methods in the program. There is another concept in object orientation or an object oriented program, which is the concept of class. So let us understand what actually a class is. In order to understand a class, let us take an example. I show you two markers in my hand. Now, if I take out one marker from these two markers, what this marker is known as? Your answer will be a marker. But this is not the right answer. The answer is, this is an example of this marker. See the movement of my hand. When I take out this marker from here, your answer is a marker, but this is not a marker. This is an example of a marker. So what is a marker? A marker is collection of objects which has similar type of attributes. Now these attributes resembles the attributes of the marker. So if I consider those two markers collectively, they form a class. Why they are forming a class? Because they are having objects having similar type of attributes. And when I take out one marker from this collection, this marker becomes an example of this marker class. So in order to define a class is a collection of similar type of objects, similar in terms of type of attributes. The entire concept of object orientation stands on four pillars. Whichever technology implements these four pillars, they are termed as object-oriented technologies. Those four pillars are abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance, and polymorphism. Now let us understand what is abstraction. In order to understand abstraction, let's take a case study where in my object-oriented program, I am going to design a class, and that class will map to a real life employee. Now when I am designing that class, looking at a real life employee, the attributes which will come in my mind, which I will consider in my class of that employee, are employee ID, employee name, employee salary, employee designation, employee address, so on and so forth. But apart from these attributes, that employee is having certain other attributes also, like his hair color, his eye colors, his height, his weight. But when I was designing the class, by looking at that real-time employee, I was only considering those attributes which are relevant to my application. And in the process, I have not considered those attributes of the employee, like his hair color, his height, his weight, which are not relevant to my application. So abstraction is a process of considering only those attributes while designing a class which are relevant to the application. In this scenario, if you see, my class is an abstract model which has been created from a real life employee and he is a real model. So abstraction is a creation of an abstract model which is a class in my program. By looking at the real model and considering only those attributes which are relevant to the application. Now the next question is, how do we implement abstraction in my program? We implement abstraction in my program whenever we are designing a class. So designing a class itself is implementing the process of abstraction. Now let us understand what is encapsulation. Encapsulation is a process of keeping the property and the method of an object together. Now how this keeping the property and the method together benefits the program? Let us understand by an example. Let's say I am one of the account holder of a bank. Now me as an account holder, I will have my own balance and I will have my own withdraw method. So whenever I execute my withdraw method, my property called balance gets changed. Now I only have the right to change the value of the property balance by executing the withdraw method. If someone else is executing my withdraw method and changing my balance, then that is not a legal operation of that balance. So what does encapsulation ensures? Encapsulation ensures that legal assignment should be done on the properties of an object, and legal assignment can only be done when the method of that object is trying to access the property of that object. No other object can have the access of the property of another object, and this is only possible by the process of encapsulation. Now let us understand what is inheritance. Now inheritance is a movement from generalization to specialization. Now let us understand what is this movement all about. In order to understand this, let's say I want to develop a car factory. So I have a lot of money and I want to develop a car factory. So I will be developing a car factory. Now I understand that when this car factory is developed in future, variety of cars will be manufactured here. And to me, a car is only a car when it has certain properties like steering, brake and gear. To me, a car is a car when these properties are present inside the car. This much of information I have when I am developing the car factory. Now, once the car factory is developed in future, let's say a car called Maruti is getting manufactured in this car factory. Now when Maruti is getting manufactured in this car factory, this Maruti is a car because it has certain properties like steering, brake and gear, which has been decided when I was developing the car factory. Because for me, a car is a car only if it has a steering, brake and a gear. This much of information I had when I was developing the car factory. So when Maruti car was getting manufactured in this car factory, so it must have a steering, brake and a gear. But I did not know that a Maruti can contain another property called AC. Now this information of AC was not there when I was developing the car factory, because the bare minimum requirement for a car to become a car is it should have a steering, brake and gear. This information I was having when I was developing the car factory. But in future, this Maruti is definitely a car because it has steering, brake and gear. but it may contain an AC also, and this information I did not have when I was developing a car factory. So this property called AC is very special to Maruti. Now if you see, when I was developing the car factory, this car factory is a class which is having some general properties in it. General means whenever in future cars will be manufactured, those cars will have these three properties in it. But when I manufactured Maruti in the car factory, these general properties was definitely there, but along with these general properties, one special property called AC has come in this Maruti, which was not present in my car factory class. So what has happened is, there is a movement from general properties to some specialized properties. Now this class is a more specialized class because it is having a property called AC in it. So inheritance is a journey from generalization to specialization. It's a continuous movement from generalized classes to specialized classes, wherein the specialized classes acquires some or all the properties of the generalized class. Along with those properties, it is having some of its own specialized properties also. So if I need to define inheritance is a movement from generalization to specialization, where some or all the properties of generalized class is acquired by specialized class along with its own specialized properties. Now let us understand what is polymorphism. In order to understand polymorphism, let's take an example. Let's say you are having a pet at your home. What is pet in object-oriented parlance? Pet is an object. Now when you show a bread to that pet, the behavior of pet is, it comes towards you. But when you show a stick toward the same pet, the behavior of the pet is, it runs away from you. So if I want to summarize this entire concept of polymorphism, polymorphism is a process by which an object exhibits different behaviors when provided with different types of stimuli. In this example, the object is the pet. This bread and stick are stimuli to this object, and coming forward and running away based on the stimuli are the behaviors of this pet. We implement polymorphism in object-oriented program using some concepts called method overloading and method overriding. Hope you have learned from this video. For more videos like this, please subscribe to our EdTech channel, Fictionary.net. Like, comment, and share our videos. Thank you.